What up, world? Back again in the mix. Welcome to another episode of Hosted by Decent with me, your host Decent. These hosts be straight stupid, but I be straight lucid. Bang. My guest at this time is one of the dopest, and I mean dopest, women rappers, because we're getting rid of the word female. I'm not even gonna say women rappers, just one of the dopest rappers that I've encountered in the last few years. And now she's here to talk about everything under the sun, from her appearance on My Big Homie. And I say big homie in the sense that I'll meet him one day, he's gonna take me on his wing. Sway, you know, freestyle, you know. You did your thing, by the way.
Thank you.
You know what I'm saying? And a host of other things that she's been a part of. Ladies and gentlemen, please give it up for Cypherella. Woo! Tell us a little bit about, you know, your origin as an MC, because you kind of have, you know, an interesting dynamic here, you know. Brooklyn based, but by way of,
I'm Alabama all day, all night. But it's funny that you ask about my MC origins. I was in a blues band when I was like 7-ish, and I really wanted to be a singer, but all of the other women, females, girls wanted to be singers too. So I was like, I'm not gonna sing.
Rap.
Actually, I'm gonna play the guitar. And then one day, I don't even remember how it happened, and they decided to add like this rap joint to Stevie Ray Vaughan's song. He has a song called TikTok. Mm-hmm. And they added a rap joint to it. And I was like, I'm gonna do that. And then it just took over after that. And I was with this guy, and he would do half and I would do half. And eventually I took his part. And it was just all me, all day. And ever since then, I just wanted to do something with music, particularly hip-hop.
As a woman in hip-hop, do you kind of find yourself torn when it comes to, you know, the fact that, once again, there are, you know, more faces, there are more voices, you know, you have, you know, everybody under the sun that kind of represents the different spectrum of hip-hop when it comes to the woman MC these days? You have, you know, your Megans, you have your Cardis, but then you have your Rhapsodies, you have your No Names, you have, you know, your Snow the Prada. Like, do you feel like, you know, yeah, you know, there's more of us, but, you know, it comes at a price, because once again the same thing is being pushed over and over again. So do you find yourself torn with the fact that there are more people, you know, more women representing, but still the same thing gets pushed to the forefront?
But I just wish that they got a lot of the backing that the more commercialized women got. But I'm not torn. Kudos.
Do your thing.
Yes, keep paving the way, opening doors for us.
Yeah. With the way music is now, you don't necessarily have to be number one. It's all about occupying your own space, occupying your own lane. So how important is, you know, your own lane and, you know, your own sort of voice to you as an artist right now?
Very. I'm still finding my voice. I was explaining this to someone, I think it was a friend of mine, just trying to explain the difference between Omega B, who was my previous pen name, and now Cypherella. This is the first project that Cypherella has put out, although I put out an album, 2211, that wasn't written by Cypherella, it was written by Omega B. And I find that in growing myself as an artist, I have to find what voice I want. And my mind is going to change, and I need to be okay with having my mind to change. So I think that it's gonna always be very important for me to find my voice, because how would you feel if you couldn't create the content that you wanted when you wanted to, you know?
Back to you saying that you kind of made the shift from your original pen name to Cypherella. What prompted that? Because I know one of the things that artists are so conditioned to do now is be consistent, be it, you know, on their own or, you know, with a label or whatever the case may be. So that kind of sudden pivot for, you know, one name to another can often make or break an artist, you know, not just somebody that's on top, but somebody who's kind of starting as well. Did you fear any of that when you decided to change your name?
I feel like as an artist, I can't provide all of myself if I don't feel like I have the room to figure out all of myself. So no, it didn't. I wasn't afraid.
So for the people that, you know, were familiar with their original name and then, you know, saw the sudden switch, like, what were their reactions to it?
They liked it. They saw it as growth. I feel like it's a long backstory.
Oh, we got time. It's your interview.
So it's the shortest version of it is Omega was my born name.
It's a very nice name.
Yeah, but then my parents gave me up for adoption, and my name switched to Brandy. And when I moved to New York after this tragic event, I felt like Omega never got a chance to grow. So I adopted the name Omega. And I played around and I explored a lot of spirituality while under the guise of Omega, and that's when I wrote. A lot of Omega's material was definitely power to the people, and it's giving you straight facts. It's just like, Babylon exists. They're poisoning our water. So it was that type of content.
A lot of third eye, you know.
I can't remember which Outkast member it was. I think it was Andre who was like, speeches only reach the people who already know about it. So this is how we go about it. And that's when the shift started changing. Like, yes, I want to enlighten those who may want to be enlightened, because you don't know. You might hear something that sparks something like, oh, what she's talking about? Then you go look it up and you start learning more and more about what it is to be black, or what it is to be your type of black, mm-hmm. or whatever it is. And I felt like Omega couldn't do that successfully because it was music, but it wasn't music that a lot of people would be able to relate to.
You wanted to spread out a little bit more, show more personality. That way, you know, more people will be drawn into who you are as a person,
yes,
and as an artist.
Yes, you better understand.
Let's talk about your Sway appearance.
Ooh.
You know,
that was exciting.
For you to be on that platform, I can imagine, as an MC, as somebody, you know, who I'm sure grew up watching MTV and seeing Direct Effect, and when Sway sat down with Eminem, Kanye West, 50 Cent, you, like, this is a moment. Mm-hmm. So what was that whole experience like for you?
Nerve-wracking. Rodney, great PR agent. Rodney actually contacted me. It wasn't even 24 hours before I was supposed to be on Sway. He was like, yo, Syfe. Syfe. You want to be on Sway tomorrow?
So casually, right?
I'm like, okay, when is it? Tomorrow. What?
You made it seem like y'all going out for nachos.
I gotta get something to eat. So the whole time I'm at the house, I'm like, I have to freestyle on Sway tomorrow. And my roommate was like, you need to calm down. I'm like, I can't. I don't know what I'm going to do. I think I was up that whole night.
I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do with my locks. Like, there's a lot going on. So, we talked about your origin, name change, you know, the experience with Sway. And in tried and true fashion, now we're going to play a game. Now, the name of this game is called Civil War. And since you're priding yourself on being, you know, tried and true Southerner,
mm-hmm.
but you know, you live in here in the Big Apple.
Mm-hmm.
I'm gonna give you two options, one from the North, one from the South, and you're gonna have to tell me which one is your favorite and why. Now, to be forewarned, they're gonna be as ridiculous as I could possibly make them.
This is great. So let's do it.
Civil War, best hip hop duo, Mobb Deep or Outkast?
Outkast.
We already know why, so we're not gonna go further into it. Civil War, best overweight rapper, New York's Fat Joe or Florida's Rick Ross?
I'ma go with Rick Ross. Yes. Yeah. Ironically, they're both skinny now.
Yeah, I was just about to, when I was formulating this, I was like, you know what? They're both slender these days, so I don't know if this qualifies.
I got it.
You know, the overall concept is that, you know, they've been on the husky side for a majority of their career. Best troll. We have New York's Tekashi 6ix9ine and Atlanta's Soulja Boy.
Yeah, I'm gonna go with Tekashi. That's how you.
Yeah.
There's no explanation needed. It's just. He's the one who's snitching, right?
I mean, cooperating. But yeah, snitching.
North or South,
anyway. Snitching either way. Civil War, best party/riot starter. Any Up by MOP or Nuck If You Buck?
I'm like, if he doesn't say Nuck If You Buck, I'm going with Nuck If You Buck. Because to this day, it doesn't matter where you are. Or maybe it does, but if that song comes on in the South to this day, yeah, especially I come in the club, shaking, and now I actually have lost.
Yo, let me tell you something.
You can't tell me anything.
When these reach swinging length, like, we be in the party, and as soon as that verse comes on, I'm hair tied up, ripping it out, and I'm just going stupid.
You have to. You. Whiplash.
Civil War, best ad-lib, DMX's Bark or Lil Jon's Yeah?
I'm gonna say Lil Jon,
mm-hmm.
only because the way you say the yeah,
mm-hmm.
no matter where you are, they're gonna know that you're yeah-ing because of Lil Jon. Like, they're gonna know that you're associating that with Lil Jon. Whereas if I just go around barking,
Some people might think you have Tourette's.
You know? So I'm gonna go with the yeah. Even though the bark, it's the bark.
Most annoying DJ. New York's Funkmaster Flex versus DJ Khaled.
I'm gonna go with Flex though. And that's only because I was in an Uber ride the other day.
But before you even go into your story, just stop me whenever I'm wrong. I could probably pinpoint why you're saying Flex. Let me guess, there was a song that was coming on that you wanted to hear, but he kept bringing it back and dropping it.
Oh my God.
Is that what happened?
Yes, and I'm like, I just want to listen to the song. And it was like, every time it was, and I get that's what the DJ does. I get it. But this is like 1 o'clock in the afternoon.
Like, why are you so hype? It's just so funny, even with the ad-libs, like in between the bombs, he'll just say something that doesn't correlate whatsoever.
With the
whiskey, real nasty New York.
Meanwhile, you're listening to
alternate street parking in effect. Make sure you do your taxes.
Flex. All in the middle of Taylor Swift's new album. You're like, what is
Flex,
this?
Flex, slow down. What is happening? So, you have a project coming out.
I do.
Next year. Tell us a little about it.
So, my project is entitled 7. And it will be dropping February the 28th, 2020. I really enjoy this project because it deals with the 7 deadly sins, which is me still exploring my spirituality, but also giving in to we out here sinning, you know? And it's okay because we can repent.
So what inspired the concept behind, you know, just your fascination with spirituality, or?
It's weird how inspiration comes to me, right? Like, it literally just comes. I'm like, I'm gonna name my project 7. But I don't know why I'm gonna name it 7. It's like the reason comes later. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it's dealing with the 7 sins. And again, when I was telling you that I feel like this is the first project that Cypherella has put out, it's like Cypherella is being born, right? So we're all born into sin.
Original sin is what they call it.
Yeah, original sin. So that's what this is going to explore. And it's kind of funny because I was trying to come up with like creative ways to do a listening party. And now I'm diving into hip hop theater because I want to actually put on a show for the listening party for this project.
So with the new year approaching, you know, with everything that you've done under your old moniker, with all the expectations that you had for everything under Cypherella, what's the new year and beyond that looking like for you?
Just identifying who I am. Really putting my foot into the game and consistency. Right now I've been inconsistently consistent.
As most people are.
To support the album, the EP, I want to go to Europe. So I'm working on traveling in Europe and doing some shows in Europe. But it definitely makes sense if I do a US prior to that. Mm-hmm. So I feel like I'm starting to plan, but my timelines are so tiny. Like I need to be able to see further in advance. And I feel like that's really what I'm gonna work on.
But as an artist, you tend to formulate once you see where your art and how your art is reaching people, and then you pretty much go from there. And without a shadow of a doubt, I know that, you know, for next year and, like I said, years to come, you're definitely gonna be somebody that we're gonna be hearing a lot more about throughout the course of the genre's evolution as far as, you know, women in hip hop, and once again, not just limiting, you know, it to, you know, just gender, but, you know, an MC in general.
I hope it's good news.
Good. Nothing but good news here on the show. Once again, Cypherella, thank you so much for stopping by. Where can people find you at on social media?
Social media, I'm on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter, and Spotify, and Apple Music, and iTunes. It's all under Cypherella. I am Cypherella, which is Cypherella.
Well, one take hold.
That was good, right?
Once again, guys, this has been another episode of Hosted by Decent. Make sure you subscribe to the Pop Dutch YouTube channel. Make sure you click the bell to be notified of brand new content. And once again, we're a podcast. You can catch the full unedited audio of this on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and iHeartRadio. So make sure you tune in. Also follow me on social media at Decent. That's DEASCENT. And we will see you in the new year. Peace.